He knows it's good to be in the house of God. Amen?
Amen,
yes. Amen. Amen,
amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. It feels good to be in the house of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I said last Sunday or the Sunday before, David said, I could be anywhere else, but I'd rather be in the house of God. If I could just be a doorkeeper at the house of God. He didn't care about, I want to be in this position or I want to be in that position. He said, if I could just be a doorkeeper at the house of God. Why? Because he knew in the tabernacle, in the house of God, there was a presence there. Mm-hmm. And if I could just be at the door so I can just get some of that presence of God, I know I can keep going on with the Lord. That's why you come here every Sunday.
Amen.
If I can just get the presence of God, I can keep going forward with God. Amen.
Amen.
You need the presence of the Lord in your life.
Amen.
We, none of us. We're all made of the same stuff, right? We're all flesh and blood. Amen.
Amen.
The pastor or the preacher don't get a pass. Amen. The Bible says that the teacher will receive what? Stricter judgment. It says those who put them in the position of a teacher shall receive stricter judgment. So we also need the presence of God as well. Praise Jesus.
Amen.
We're flesh and blood, just like you. We all go through the same things. But God has made a way of escape. Hallelujah.
Amen.
What is that escape? The cross. He made a way where there seemed to be no way to come back to the Father. And that way was through Jesus Christ. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Amen?
Amen.
We can do all things through Christ, which strengthens us. We have to come to that revelation in God. We have to come to that revelation knowing that, wait a minute, I can do it, but I can only do it through Him. Wait a minute, I can't do it, Lord. I can't do it outside of Your presence. I can't do it outside of studying Your Word. I can't do it without spending time with You every day.
Amen.
Every day when you get up, a couple of days go by, you will start to feel the heaviness come upon your life. You will start to feel the weariness come upon your life. Why? Because the flesh lusts after the Spirit constantly.
Amen. Amen.
It doesn't take a break. It doesn't say, okay, I decided to take a break today. No. That's why the Bible says what? Exercise. How many of us exercise in here? Anybody exercise? Does it take discipline? It takes some discipline, right, to exercise, right? You got to get up. You got to turn on the insanity or the video. And you gotta, you don't want to do it, right? You don't want to turn on that video because you're like, I want to sweat and shower. And I'm like, oh, I don't want to have to get in there and turn it on. And after the first 10 minutes, you get the endorphins kicking. You're like, I'm ready to do this. It's the same thing with prayer. You have to exercise self-discipline. You're not going to be, I just want to be led into the Spirit of the Lord. I'll just be led when God leads me into His presence. If you're counting on being led by the Spirit of the Holy Ghost into prayer, you're never going to get into prayer. If you're waiting for your flesh to lead you into exercising, you're never going to exercise. Why? Because the flesh wants the salt and sugars. Amen? It wants to sit on the couch. It wants to turn on TV. It doesn't want to do anything. You have to exercise self-discipline as you do in the physical as well as the spiritual. After 5 minutes in prayer, you didn't feel like it when you got up. But when you went in there and you knelt before the Lord and 5 minutes goes by and you don't know what to pray for, that's why the Spirit of the Lord helps you. The Bible says you know not what to pray for. The Spirit of God helps you pray so that He can help you get in. But there's something you have to do. That's why it's called a relationship. Amen? We walk together. He's not going to do it for us, but He'll help us. Amen? When we get into the presence of God, 5 minutes goes by, all of a sudden, every temptation, every worry, every trial that you've been going through is dealt with in the presence of God. Why? Because the Bible says, in His presence is what? Fullness of life. Fullness of power. There's joy in His presence. Amen?
Amen.
So when you get into God's presence, you're going to start to discover that, wait a minute, this is how we do it. It's not I. It's not by might. It's not by strength. It's by Thy Spirit, saith the Lord.
Amen.
Come on now.
Amen.
You've got to come to that revelation in your walk with God to know that I cannot do it. But
Amen.
In Christ I can do all things.
Amen.
It is through the power of the Holy Ghost we're able to conquer what? The flesh. I am more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. Conquering what daily? The flesh. That's what we conquered. The devil was destroyed at the cross. What is his solicitation only in the earth is whispering in the Christian's ear. That's all he has power over you. The power of the devil has been broken at the cross. Amen?
Amen.
He crucified the flesh and its appetites at the cross. That is our foundation. So we know we have power in Christ Jesus to conquer the things that the flesh wants to take. Amen? We have that power, we have that right, and we have that privilege. The only thing the devil has now is, you know you're no good. You know you're not living holy enough. Well, you're never going to live holy enough. But you try every day. You repent. And it gets each better. It gets each day. It's gone a month without doing those things you know that are going to destroy you. It's been 2 months. It's been 3 months. All of a sudden, it's been a year. Because you, as the Christian, as the believer, are realizing, wait a minute, I can't do it. But I can do all things through Christ. I got to get y'all to get that revelation in your spirit. Because why? We're all trying to do it. I got to make sure that before I go to the house of God, I got to be cleaned up. I got to be right with God. I'm not living right with God, so I can't go to church. How many times have you heard that? I can't go to church because I'm not living right. That's why you go to church. Because we can't live right without God. Amen?
Amen.
This is where we come. So that we can receive what Jesus Christ provided by the move of the Holy Ghost. Amen?
Amen.
So when the Word goes over you, keeps going over you, what does it do? It begins to renew a mind.
Amen.
Because the mind is desperately corrupt. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Does funny things, doesn't it? Y'all minds, y'all, you know, minds are... Y'all don't get funny stuff that fly through the day and drive and all that. What? Why? You know, so there is a constant renewing of a right mind and a right spirit through what? Through the washing and the watering of God's Word that has to go over you. That's why you come to church every Sunday, because the corporate meeting of ourselves, that when we come together, this is where we encourage one another. How do we encourage each other, Brother Jesse or Pastor Jesse, when I'm just sitting here doing nothing? When I see my brother here, it encourages me. When I see my sister here, it encourages me. When I see someone not here, what happens? Discouragement. Where's my brother? Where's my sister at? Where are they? Your very presence in the church does a mighty impact to those who are on the other side of you.
Amen.
You don't even know what's going on in their life. But when they see you in that chair, it gives them encouragement to know that you're still coming.
Hallelujah.
No matter what happened during the week, they're here in the church house. Amen? So when they see you coming, they know. Doesn't matter what happened, they're still here. They're coming to get what God has for them. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Come on. Now, that's how you encourage one another. You need the corporate setting of the body of Christ, because there is an anointing in the house of God when you come. I can just do it by myself. You can't. That's why it's called the body. We need one another. Amen? You encourage each other as you're sitting as a body here. Well, we're so-and-so. Pray for them. Just pray for them. Amen?
Amen.
All right, let's get into the message. The title of the message today is going to be, God, I need peace. How many of us need peace?
Amen.
Is there a way we can experience peace continually? Yes, you say yes. Is there peace that God gives us when we experience in seasons? It seems like I have peace. And then a week goes by, and all of a sudden it's gone. We experience that too as well, right? I'm going to show you how to keep it continually. It's going to take some discipline. It's going to take some action on your part, right? But the Bible says the goodness of God leads to repentance. What's the goodness of God? Because you hear a lot of that on Christian television. The goodness of God. The grace of God. God forgives. God forgives. That leads me to repentance. So no matter how much I sin, God always forgives me. That's not the goodness of God.
Amen.
They're misinterpreting the scripture. The goodness of God is He allows you to experience that peace in the midst of your garbage. Do y'all hear me now? In the midst of all that you're doing, you wake up, you know, forgive me, and then He drops that peace on you like, I don't deserve that. I don't understand that, Lord, how you're so good to me. That's the goodness of God, that He's giving you a taste. He's letting you taste the goodness. So that you can experience some of that goodness, so it what leads you to come out of that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, I want to continue walking this. I don't want to deal with that stuff no more out there. You're coming to a place where you're experiencing the goodness of God, and it's leading you what? To repentance.
Amen.
Saying, Lord, what does repentance mean? Repentance means to turn the opposite way and walk in a different direction. It's not that you repent, and then all of a sudden you repent, And then the next day you're giving over. There is no true peace in the Christian's life if you continue to give over to what that God's trying to pull you out of. That's the goodness of God that leads you to what? Repentance. That goodness wants to make you change. You want to change. That's the goodness of God. Amen?
Amen.
Everybody understand that? All right, go with me to Hebrews chapter 4. You guys are drawn today. I feel y'all drawing today. Amen?
Amen.
God wants to do something with the body of Christ. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 3. Lord, I need rest. Lord, I need rest. Do you need rest? I need rest, Lord. What is rest? What is it in relationship with? Rest is peace. If you have peace in your body, you have peace with the Father, you're going to be at rest. Everything around you is going to be at rest. Amen? And I'm going to show you how to get to that place of rest that you can stay there continually, perpetual. What does perpetual mean? You ever been to the funeral that said perpetual? Care, that means it's continual. It doesn't never go away. That means forever. Amen. And some of you are trying to get there with your finances. Perpetual finances.
Amen.
You'll get there when you understand how important tithe and offering is. But we're talking about rest for your soul. A lot of us don't have rest. Don't understand about the peace of God. How we can enter into that peace and be at peace. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, let's go to chapter 3. We're going to read and just dissect the scriptures. Let's start in chapter 3, verse 5. Are we all there?
Yes.
All right, let's read. It says, but Jesus deserves far more glory than Moses, of course.
Hebrews 3.
Hebrews chapter 3, verse 5. Are we all there? Are we there? Amen? Okay, verse 5. Moses was certainly faithful. Oh, we're down to the bottom. Let's go to verse 3. The Holy Ghost wants us to read that. Let's read that.
Amen.
But Jesus deserves far more glory than Moses, just as a person who builds a house deserves more praise than the house itself. For every house has a builder, but the one who built everything is God. All right, we're building a foundation, so stay with me. It says Moses, verse 5, was certainly faithful in God's house as a servant. His work was an illustration of the truths God will reveal later. That means that everything Moses did was a type and shadow of what was to come through the cross of Christ. Everything before the cross is Old Testament, right? Everything after the cross is New Testament. So what does that mean? The law is done away with? No. Jesus came to what? Not do away with the law, but to fulfill the law. What part of the law? Ceremonial law. There's a lot of teaching going on behind the pulpit that is misinterpreted. And it's very, very dangerous. You have to realize that what Jesus came to fulfill is what the Levitical priesthood set up in the Old Testament was the sacrifices and the offerings that they came to bring to the church. Amen? The tabernacle at that time. Y'all understand that?
Amen.
They came in to bring offerings for their sin. But God said it wasn't good enough. Amen? It only covered. It didn't do away with. So Jesus got sent to the earth to die as a sacrifice. It was a type and shadow of what they did in the tabernacle by bringing the offerings. Christ came to be that offering for us, and all the sins were laid upon him. Now the ceremonial laws, we don't have to do anymore.
Amen.
Because Jesus fulfilled that part of the law. Plus, we weren't a part of that covenant, right?
Amen.
That was for Israel. Now, God made a way where there seemed to be no way for us to come back through the cross of what Christ did. Now we're in the New Testament. So does that mean the Ten Commandments have been done away with?
No.
Who said no? Come on, amen. Hallelujah. That's good. Why? Because that is considered the moral law. Amen. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not steal. Those are still part of what God commands of his people. Amen. That's nothing to do with ceremonial law. So
amen.
We're in the New Testament. Amen. So we still abide by those things. But what the law could not do, Christ came and fulfilled. Now we have the power of the Holy Ghost to fulfill that what God requires of us. Because we couldn't do it before the cross. Why? Because when he died, he went to heaven and he sent the Holy Spirit to fill our lives.
That's right. Amen.
Amen. So now we don't get the right to say that the devil made me do it. Why? Because the works of Satan and the works of the flesh were put down where? At the cross. Amen.
Amen.
All right, let's keep going. Are we there?
Amen.
It says in verse 6, So we know his work was an illustration. Moses' work was an illustration of the truths God will reveal later, talking about Christ. But Christ, as the Son, is in charge of God's entire house, talking about us. And we are God's house, amen? If we keep our courage and remain confident in our hope in Christ. Our hope is in Christ. What is the hope we have in Christ? Everyone walks around and says, why do you have such hope? We have hope when we put our hope in the resurrection and also the rapture. Amen? Amen. That's our hope in Christ, that knowing he's not going to leave us in the ground.
Amen.
That he's going to come back. Who was the one that went first? Jesus. He was the first of many among the brethren to be resurrected. Now we have a hope in Christ that God raised Jesus, and now he's seated at the right hand of the Father. Now we too can put our hope in Christ that when we die, we have a better place that we're going to. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So we don't have to be afraid of death no more. Death no longer has control over us. Amen?
Amen.
But we're still in this flesh. We haven't put on our new bodies. We're not in our resurrected bodies. Amen?
Amen.
Everybody understand that? The flesh still wants to do what the flesh wants, but we have power over the flesh.
Amen.
6, it says here in verse 7, that, and now we're going to get to the meat of God's word here. This is the fun part. That is why the Holy Spirit says, the Holy Ghost is trying to say something to us, amen? The Holy Spirit has said today, when you hear his voice, don't harden your hearts as Israel did when they rebelled, when they tested me in the wilderness. Now I want y'all to look up here. Let me get my marker. Y'all enjoying this?
Yeah. Amen.
Y'all going to learn something today. Because some of y'all want to enter into God's peace. Y'all want to enter into his rest. And it's very simple. God's already provided everything we need at the cross. Satan was destroyed. The flesh was destroyed. The works of the flesh have been destroyed. Amen? Mm-hmm. Though he still roams around seeking who he may devour, the devil, he roams around like what? Like a roaring lion. What does a lion do?
Roar.
That's all he does. Makes a lot of noise. And when you begin to serve God and start to walk upright before the Lord and decide to get committed to church, and decide to wake up every Sunday, that lion is going to roar loud. Because he don't want you. That's another person he's lost from his darkness, his kingdom of darkness. So what's he going to do? He's going to send his best to you. He's going to send everything he has at you. And he's going to send those things that you're familiar with. He's not going to send foreign things to you. He's going to send those things that he had you bound with in the world. That's why it's called familiar spirits that come minister. But all they're doing is trying to... How do you destroy those things? In prayer. Coming to church. In the Word. He promised that.
Amen.
He promised he would do it. But you got to do something. Amen?
Amen.
So here we are. Oh, yeah. Here it is. The rest. Oh, the rest. I want so bad to be in that place, right? Peace. Oh, love it. And what's this over here? I write all the squiggly lines because that's the way it looks when you're in the wilderness. It's like you're all over the place when you're in the wilderness. Amen? And we're going to see how we get here. Some of us are here in the wilderness. Just like the Israelites were. They got set from Egypt. Moses led them out of Egypt. What was the first thing God did? Took them right into the wilderness. Why so mean God? Why didn't he just take them from there right to the peace, rest and everything? Because he knew what was in man. He knew what would they do if they came right from... Here's Egypt. They were in slavery for 400 some years. And finally, Moses got sent over there. He was the type and shadow of the Savior, how Christ saves us out of the world. Amen. That's why he was an illustration. So he came. As soon as they got out of the wilderness, Egypt, they went right into the wilderness. Why didn't God just take them from here and put them right in the area of rest and peace? Why? Because he knows that some of us, if he takes us right out of the world and puts us here, we're not going to stay there. Because we didn't go through any kind of testing. We didn't go through any kind of... refining, growing, maturing, and building in our lives.
Amen.
Amen? We have to go through this. Every one of us go through this. None of us get out. None of us is exempt from the wilderness.
Amen.
Even Christ. Oh. As soon as he was baptized in the Holy Ghost, where'd he go? Went straight into the wilderness. So none of us get exempt. Amen. There's a lot of blessings in the wilderness because we don't have to stay there like Israel did for 40 years. They were like maybe 5 miles from the kingdom, from the promised land. Some of us are right there like, oh Lord, but you want to stay here. And we're going to show you in Scripture how to come out of it.
Amen.
Y'all enjoying this?
Amen.
You don't want to be in the wilderness. There's a lot of lions out there. A lot of thorns and thistles. Today, when you hear His voice, the Holy Ghost, don't harden your hearts as Israel did when they rebelled and when they tested me in the wilderness. There your ancestors tested and tried my patience, even though they saw my miracles for 40 years. They saw the miracles. For 40 years, God provided manna in the wilderness. Fresh manna, food, in the wilderness. You go out in the wilderness, there's no trees out there. There's no vegetation. There's nothing out there that you can cultivate and plant and grow. It was dry. It was a desert land out there. And God provided fresh manna, wafers, they said. Honey wafers that came. Each time they came out in the morning and they gathered those wafers, they had as much as they wanted to eat. And their sandals never grew old. 40 years they had sandals. You imagine having sandals that were worn out? 40 years. And they still. How many times in the church we see God move? Give us miracles. Give us a healing. And then when the time comes for testing, I don't want that. Lord says, give up something? No, Lord. And then you say, and then the trial comes. Did I not take care of you last time? Did I not show you that I would get you out of that situation? And then what do? As flesh, we begin to complain and murmur. The Lord's not moving quick enough. I just don't see nothing happening. God, I'm not serving you. I want to go to that church anymore. I'm done, Lord. This is too hard, Lord. Is that any of us? We know nobody does that? So what happens? They complained and murmured just like they did in here. They tried and they tested God the Father. How? They tested His patience. Some of us are testing God's patience in you. He is merciful and graceful because of Christ. His mercy and grace endures. But the Bible, it made it in the New Testament that He says, don't frustrate the grace of God. That grace is giving you what? Space. Space to what? To get it together. He's giving you time right now. There is an open door for some of y'all to come in and get planted and rooted right now. And you feel the wooing of God's Spirit pulling you and pulling you and pulling you.
Amen.
That's why I said, don't ignore the Holy Ghost. Don't ignore it. Don't ignore Him. Because He's drawing you right now. He's drawing you. He's drawing you. And when you begin to ignore Him, I'm going to get my groove on tonight. You hear the Holy Ghost. You know you hear Him. Come on. You know you hear Him, right? He is all up in your ear like that. What are you doing? What are you doing? And you're feeling the conviction. You're already feeling bad before you even get there. Oh my gosh, are you trying to still have a good time? You know you're not having a good time over there. And you're over here, okay, I gotta quiet down the Holy Ghost. I still hear the Holy Ghost. That stuff don't work. It just makes it worse. Now you're in a drunken stupor state, you're like, oh, I just made it worse, Lord. I'm walking around buzz and still hearing the Holy Ghost. Oh my gosh, Lord, what do I do? And then you get angry and take it out on everybody else because you're convicted. You're so angry. The Bible says, where are the wars and the fights going on? It's going on in here. Because you harden your heart against the Holy Ghost. Say right here, what does it say? Today, when you hear His voice, today God's speaking to you. Don't harden your hearts. Because when you ignore Him, what happens? The heart becomes hardened. What is when it becomes hardened, what happens? You become angry, frustrated, because the Lord has something better for you. When you begin to yield to God's Spirit, otherwise you don't stay here. I don't know why I'm so tormented. The devil keeps attacking me. Where were you? Oh, nowhere. Where have you been? At home? Mm-hmm. Have you been in the Holy of Holies? Have you been in God's presence? Have you been in His Word? Have you communed with God today? Have you put on worship music and just let the Lord minister to you? How long? How long has it been? It's been a long time. Here we go. Today, when you hear His voice, don't harden your hearts as Israel did. This story made it in Hebrews. This is in the New Testament. The Holy Spirit put this
story in the New Testament for a reason, to warn us as Christians that there's a lot of teaching going behind the pulpit that I'm saved. Once I'm saved, that's it. No matter what I do, I'm saved. That's a lie. Don't believe that. There's something we have to do, amen? In order to stay in Christ Jesus, we have to be in Christ Jesus, right? Today, when you hear His voice, don't harden your hearts as Israel did when they rebelled. When they tested me in the wilderness, there your ancestors tested and tried my patience, even though they saw my miracles for 40 years. 40 years! So verse 10 says, so I was angry with them, and I said, their hearts always turn away from me. They refuse to do what I tell them. So in my anger, I took an oath, they will never enter my place of rest. As long as you continue to ignore the leading of God's Spirit, not doing what you know to do as a believer, not doing the things you know that are going to hurt you out there, you can rebel all you want. It's going to be a miserable walk with God as far as the Christian. You can go out there and go to the clubs and hang around with that one and be around this and be around those environments and be around those folks that talk a certain way. And you as a Christian know you need to come out from amongst them and be separate, be consecrated. You'll live a miserable Christian life. You may have salvation. You may be the one that, like my wife has spoken many times, if you're fanning the flames of fire, just barely making it into the gates. Here I am, Lord. And I want to be the one that Christ comes up and says, my faithful son, well done. Well done. Well done.
Amen.
Coming up and saying, wait a minute, let me check the books real quick. What's your name again? Oh yeah, you're here. Yeah. Okay, you can go on that side over there. You don't want Christ to do that, right? There's a better place for us that God is talking about as far as rest and peace. Amen?
Amen.
Alright, let's keep going. It says, so I was angry with them, and I said, their hearts always turn away from me. They refuse to do what I tell them. So in my anger, I took an oath, they will never enter my place of rest. Be careful then, hand of God ministry, dear brothers and sisters. Make sure that your own hearts are not evil and unbelieving, turning you away from the living God. Unbelief. Evil. Anytime you get around that, it's going to turn you away from God. Every time.
Amen.
I don't care if they've been my best friend since I was a little baby. I grew up with them. They're my friend. They will destroy you. They will destroy you. Amen? Because what happens when you get around that environment? If there's unbelief there, if there's evil there, it will contaminate your faith. Eventually, it will lead you out of the house of God. It'll lead you away from the fellowship of God. And then you won't want to be around the house of God anymore. Okay? We'll get to the good stuff in a minute. Come on. We got to get ourselves out of the wilderness first, right? Before we can start enjoying the rest and peace God has for us. Oh, let's go. Okay, verse 13. You must warn each other every day. Where do we do that? In the church house. Come to church. That you must warn each other every day while it is still today, so that none of you will be deceived by sin and hardened against God. The deception of sin is that it comes in very subtle. Oh, it's just a little taste. A little wine for the stomach's sake. Amen? Right? Just a little look here. A little taste here. A little listen here. That's why Jesus came and He washed the disciples' feet. When He came to Peter, He said, no, wash everything. He says, only need your feet be washed. Why? Because that's what takes you into sin is your feet. We need to have us all washed up. Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Let's keep going. You must warn each other every day while it is still today, so that none of you will be deceived by sin and hardened against God. For if we are faithful to the end, trusting God just as firmly when we first believed, we will share in all that belongs to Christ. When you first believe, when you first get saved, when you come to the cross, you understand what it means to give your life to Christ. And you ask for forgiveness. Jesus comes into your heart. The Holy Ghost fills you. You're on fire for God. And you start to experience something in the Lord, right?
Amen.
It says, be faithful to the end. Doesn't matter how you, not only how you start, but it's very important how you end the race. Amen?
Amen.
It's not the one who starts off. He comes and sits in the starting line. He's got his competitor next to him, and they're ready to start. Well, he started off strong. He headed out, but his endurance fell in the middle of the race.
Oh,
he had no endurance. And the guy who trained, he had endurance. He was able to go all the way to the end. The man who didn't have endurance, halfway, he took off to the side and said, I can't do this no more. I'm done. He started off great, but there was no endurance. We as a body of Christ have to learn some endurance. Endure some things. Amen?
Amen.
When you begin to endure, there is a maturity that's going to take place in your Christianity to go forward with God. But you have to endure.
Amen.
Don't give over every time the smallest wind of temptation comes. Or the smallest wind of trial comes. Or you start falling apart. Or you start giving over to the temptation. I know sometimes it comes strong. Especially those who are coming out of a life of addiction in the world. That isn't a spirit that's attacking you or you have to be delivered from. That's the mind. It's called the flesh. Amen?
Amen.
That has to come to a place to be renewed. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We give too much glory to the devil. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Too much glory. The devil, the devil, the devil. You have a flat tire, it's the devil. I bind you, devil, out of my tire. Come on. You doing that stuff? Sink dies on you, the refrigerator dies, that old devil. No, it's called life. Don't give the devil all that glory, amen? Too much glory to the devil. So when you come, you're on fire for God. All of a sudden, you've been serving the Lord for 2 or 3 years, for y'all that have been in here a long time. We had somebody come to us the other day and said, I wanted to be like I was in the beginning when I first gave my life to the Lord. I was on fire for God. I had such a love for the Lord. I wanted to be in His house every day. I wanted to be in church every day. And I just wanted to be in His presence. And now, I don't want to do those things anymore. Well, what happened to that Christian? In the beginning, God does something. The goodness of God leads you to repentance. Amen?
Amen.
The Lord will just flood you. That's why I said there's a season for some of you right now. That the Lord's drawing you.
Mm-hmm.
You got to pay attention to that drawing right now, because when you ignore it, when that drawing stops to leave you, your heart will begin to harden. And the season will come later. It'll end. And then, okay, all of a sudden I don't feel the drawing no more. While He's doing it, while you're coming in, God is blessing y'all. He's drawing y'all. He's putting you on fire. He's blessing you. And then for those who are mature, been serving the Lord for years, all of a sudden I just don't feel like it no more. What happened? God requires of you. Much given, much required. To much more given, that much more required.
Amen.
You can go to this service, that service, Lord. I went to this church, this program. I put on that CD, and the Lord said, get into prayer. That's it. Just pray. You go into prayer like, oh, Lord, I got to feed myself. I done went to that healing ministry. I done went to that ministry. I turned on that show. I turned on this TV. I listened to that preacher. I turned on Christian music, 89.3 KSBJ with all the rock music. And nothing's going on. I don't understand. Get into prayer. You get into prayer and you begin to study for yourself, you're going to see God move in your life, because that's where God is calling you now. And the fire of God will be rekindled in your life. Amen?
Amen.
Come on now. 15. Remember what it says. He's repeating himself, the Holy Ghost. Today, when you hear His voice, don't harden your hearts, as Israel did when they rebelled. As soon as they begin to rebel, and as soon as they begin to harden their hearts, they stay here. They can almost reach it, and they're like, oh, we can't reach the promised land. The promised land was a rest and a peace that God would give them. But they had to go through some things in here at this time in their walk with God. As soon as we get baptized, filled with the Holy Ghost, God drops us in the wilderness. How many of us have been dropped? Right, those guys in the military, they get dropped in these zones. You get dropped in the wilderness with your gun. And you're in the wilderness, boy, I'll tell you. And there's everything coming at you. You got to put on your gear. You got to suit up your armor. And you got to get ready. Because these are truly the last days. The enemy's not playing around. He doesn't play fair. He wants to destroy the body of believers.
Amen.
And we as a believer have something. We have a covenant that's established on better promises that Christ said, I will do it. I will do it. I will do it.
Amen.
But you got to access this power. Amen?
Amen?
Let's keep going. And who was it who rebelled against God? Even though they heard His voice, though we've heard the Word of God, we've heard the preacher say, come out. Wasn't it the people Moses led out of Egypt? And who made God angry for 40 years? Wasn't it the people who sinned? Whose corpse lay in the wilderness? How many have we seen people leave the body of Christ?
Amen.
And we're wondering why. Why? Because when the Holy Ghost begins to go to work on the believer, and He starts to go into places that are uncomfortable, and starts to cut away the old fruit, and starts to prune the Christian, and wants the Christian to be a disciple, not just a Christian, but a disciple, they run away. And when they come to a place where the Holy Ghost is moving, and they don't recognize this, the move of God's Spirit, they go away. Because they're used to hearing the stuff that's coming out of the pulpit right now. They're heaping themselves teachers that will tell them what their itching ears want to hear. You're so good. You're so wonderful. God says that you're just so great. You're so loving. And God has... That's not the gospel.
Amen.
Amen. Jesus is wonderful. Jesus is great.
Yes.
Jesus is good. Amen?
Amen.
Verse 18. And to whom was God speaking when He took an oath that they would never enter His rest? Wasn't it the people who disobeyed Him? Okay, so that's the meat of the message. I want y'all to get the revelation of your spirit. The reason we are not experiencing rest and peace is one word. Disobedience. That's it. That's as simple as it is. The obedience, the byproduct of obedience, doing what you know to do. You don't have to walk in Pastor Delisa or Pastor Jesse's shoes. He's not calling you to 2 hours prayer and study time. Amen? You'll be able to go from glory to glory as God calls you. You have to walk in what God has given you at this time in your walk with Him. Everything you know to be true, do it. And that's obedience in God's eyes. And He'll start to give you more and more. Amen? So disobedience keeps you in the wilderness. Obedience keeps you in rest and peace. Amen? And to whom was God speaking when He took an oath they would never enter His rest? Wasn't it the people who disobeyed Him? So we see that because of their unbelief, they were not able to enter His rest. Close your Bible.
Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing, but am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find. All I know is I'm not home yet. This is not assurance holding.